I'm going to be a storyteller today. Once upon a time, in the land of Hushabai, around about the wondrous times of yore, they came across a sort of box, bound up with chains and locked with locks and labeled, "Kindly do not touch, it's war." A decree was issued round about, all with a flourish and a shout and a gaily colored mascot tripping lightly on before. "Don't mess with this deadly box. Don't break the chains. Don't pick the locks. Please don't mess around with war." The children understood. Children happen to be good round about the time of yore. They didn't try to pick the locks or break the chains. They didn't play around with war. Their mothers didn't either, nor their grannies or aunts. They were sweet and gentle, pretty much the same as now. Not the ones somehow who opened up that deadly box. But someone did. Someone broke the lid and poured the insides out right across the floor. A kind of bumpy, bouncy ball, all made up of flags and guns and all the horror that comes with war. It just went bumping all about and bumping into everything in store. It didn't seem to care much who it bumped or what or where or why or for. It bumped the children mainly. And I tell you this quite plainly, where it bumps, it's very, very sore. It leaves them dead, dying, burned and crying. Of course, where it bumps, it's very, very sore. It wouldn't take much to get that ball back into the box and bind up the chains and lock the locks. All it would take is wisdom. But no one seems to care, even for the children, anymore. At least that's the way it appears. Because it's been bouncing around for years and years, in spite of all the wisdom whizzed. Since that day they came across that box, bound up with chains and locked with locks and labeled, "Kindly do not touch. It's war." That's a frightening story that I heard Jack Lennon give many years ago during the Vietnamese War. And it was reminded of me just the other day because, again, the news is so much not only of the Iraq War every day, every day, every day, but the threat of going to war with Iran, but even more poignantly to me is this threat of terrorists that are still trying to get into our country and to do the terror that they do over there. When I watch on the news and hear about buses being blown up and houses being blown up and children and parents and people, innocent people being killed, I know it could happen here. There was 9/11. It was 9/11. I watched it on television. That's my hometown, New York, New York. My children are in Philadelphia, in college. Philadelphia is one of the prime targets for the terrorists. And so in my mind, there is that threat of war coming home. I remember recently being reminded of all this because they had the filming of that wondrous book that C.S. Lewis wrote, The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. And it's a wonderful film if you've seen it. Aslan is on the move again to bring about peace and justice in spite of all the evil that exists for these children And I became aware of the fact that C.S. Lewis wrote that book because of the horrors of the Second World War, the Blitzkrieg of London, where these bombs were coming not just from bombers, but then the V-2 rockets that were just flying from the channel and landing never knew where, blowing up homes and houses and all kinds of people died. And so the children were being shipped out on trains away from London to the country, just to live away from where the danger was. And that was the setting of The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. The horror of war. And why does it exist? There is that profound division in our life, in our humanity, of goodness and evil, with virtue and degradation. That still goes on. C.S. Lewis, who wrote The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, and many other wondrous things, had a saying that I remember hearing as I was becoming a Montessori educator and a Montessori parent, and so focused on the goodness of children, the new generation. But he said something that kind of frightened me. He said, "We are all born a little bit bent. We're all born, but a little bit bent. There's something in man that is there that makes us choose evil and not good." You would think we'd all choose the good, but evidence shows us that people don't always choose the good. And I look at my own personal life. There are many, many times when I didn't choose the good, when I chose evil. I have children coming into my office every day, being sent here because they've done something inappropriate, something wrong. And I'm here to give them wisdom, not to be foolish again, but to have wisdom. And inevitably, while I'm talking with them, I begin sharing my own foolishness. That when I was your age, I remember doing something just as stupid, just as hurtful, just as wrong, and I had to make up for it by doing good thereafter. Socrates, that ancient philosopher, Socrates, the beginning of rational philosophy, used to walk around his big town, Athens, trying to help people come to understand what life was all about. He was asking them questions. He became the gadfly, the pest, because he was always asking them questions and questions. And one of the stories about Socrates is that this group of wealthy men came to see him from Athens, one of whose name was Meno. And they come to Socrates and they stop him on the road and they say, "Socrates, we come to you to ask your advice. We want someone to teach our young teenagers wisdom, virtue." And Socrates doesn't give them an answer, but gives them a question. "Well, what do you mean by virtue? If you can describe virtue to me, define virtue for me, I'll then be able to find a teacher for it. What is virtue?" And they go through this whole questioning and circling where they can't define what they mean by virtue. They're saying things like, "Well, I have a great teacher in rhetoric for my son, and I know he could become a great senator, but I want him not to be just a senator, I want him to be a virtuous senator." And the other one says, "That's true. I have a son who's studying the military arts and he could become a great general, but I don't want him just to become a great general. I want him to be a virtuous general. We want someone not just to teach the military arts or rhetoric. We want someone to teach virtue." They keep coming back to that theme. "Why can't you answer our question?" they ask Socrates. So he says, "Let me show you an answer." So there was a young boy with one of the wealthy men who was a slave, uneducated. Maybe a 9-year-old, 8-year-old boy. So he calls the boy over and he gets on his hands and knees before these men with this boy. And he begins to draw with a stick into the dirt the lines of the Pythagorean theorem. A squared plus B squared equals C squared, which was a famous mathematical mystery that Pythagoras first developed and became philosophical, theological, and just a wonder of wonders, where you could get three lines of a triangle where each line was a different length, and yet you could prove equality by the sum of the square of two sides would equal, there would be equality to the third side. For a mathematician, this was a wonder of wonders. And he doesn't teach the child a thing, but by drawing the lines of it and showing visually, experientially, how the square of this side and square of this side, if you add them, come equals the square of that side, and asking questions, the boy comes to understand and to be able to state the Pythagorean theorem when he gets done in 4 or 5 minutes of that, to the amazement of the men. And they say, well, what has that got to do with virtue? Well, Socrates is saying everything. Because I didn't teach the child the Pythagorean theorem. He came to it by his own experience. He saw it. He saw the truth of it and was able to state it. Not because he wanted to please me or to please you or even to please himself. He saw the truth of it, the reality of it, and he stated it. So what Socrates was showing them, and it was showing me and showing us, is that if you can get a child to be in the habit of attending to his experience, he could make a disinterested judgment about it, that this is good or this is not good, this is right, this is wrong, this is going the right way, this is going the wrong way, because he can see it, and he's compelled by what he experiences to say yes or no to it. That's the beginning of virtue, Socrates was saying, is to develop the habit within the child of attending with all his powers of personality to his experience and making a judgment on that, that's either right or wrong in there. Think about, for a moment, the Pythagorean theorem. It's based on not just any triangle, but a right triangle. A right triangle, as you know, looks like that. It's a right triangle. It's right. Why is it called a right triangle? Because its basic angle is right. It's 90 degrees. And then the other hypotenuse, the other line, is longer than those two. But it's related, and it can be proved equal because this is a right triangle. Rightness is where virtue comes from. Rightness is where goodness comes from. We use that term to do it right. Get it right. The slave boy got the Pythagorean theorem right because he could see the rightness of it. It made sense. It was visible. It was definite. And he could say, this is the right answer for this right. So we have that expression, get it right, which is the beginning of wisdom and virtue, is getting it right. There's a modern philosopher named Kohlberg out of Harvard University. One of the areas of philosophy is ethics. One of the things that philosophy takes up eventually is ethics, because man is meant to be ethical, morality. Morality is doing the right thing. This is why I began with the story about the box, because obviously there are people doing the wrong things, and we have such horror as murder and war and killing. So philosophers have taken up many questions about the human in human life. One of the most practical things to take up is the whole realm of ethical and morality. It's heartening to know that now in medical schools, besides teaching you biology and anatomy and all those, are now teaching ethics as well. What are the ethics of medicine? In law, what is the ethics of law? What is the ethics of business? So in the business schools, they now have an ethics course. Ethics have always been essential to mankind, because without ethics, we can go awry. We can go wrong rather than right. Kohlberg, as a philosopher, tries to define for us levels of virtue, levels of ethics that he can see in mankind. As the child develops, that his point, Socrates said that ethics demanded education, that man by nature, Socrates says, was essentially good, and when he did something wrong, it was because of ignorance. That was the ancient point of view in Socrates' day, that if you were wrongdoing was based on ignorance, but if you get the right kind of education, you would never do things wrong. Kohlberg says he doesn't totally agree with Socrates, that there are levels of development that has not much to do with education until the very end, perhaps, Kohlberg would say. Kohlberg outlines for us in the development of the human personality from childhood up kind of levels of morality based on experience. The first level he calls, forgive me for these philosophical terms, preconventional morality. Preconventional. What's conventional and what is preconventional? So preconventional morality is early childhood. It's childhood morality where the child says, this is what I should do because mama tells me to do it this way. Mama tells me what's right and wrong. And I love mama and I trust mama. Mama is the best thing in my life. And so if she says this is good, then it's good. If she says it's wrong, it's wrong. So morality based on what your parents tell you, your mother or your father tells you, Kohlberg says, is a very powerful morality for childhood. And it's based on the respect that the child has for the authority of the mother or the father. And that respect is based on the experience of their love. It's instinctive. It's experiential. So that's preconventional morality. That's the morality that says, I know it's right because mama says it's right. Or I know it's wrong. So I can get it right if I follow mom's advice. I remember my mother telling my brother Peter and me, seeing us run out between cars. We were growing up in the Bronx, and there weren't that many cars, but there were cars now being parked on the side of the road, the street, and cars coming up and down every so often. And we kids used to play in the street. The street was our playground. Since we were little, we were all playing all kinds of street games. And mom saw Pete and me running out between parked cars onto the street on Glover Street. And right away she called us to her and said, don't do that. You'll get hurt. Because you can't see the cars coming and the cars can't see you. And you run out from between two cars, you're going to get hit by a car and get very badly hurt or even killed. And I said to my mother, no, mom. You know, we run out in the street that way all the time. We don't get hit by cars. She said, not yet. Not yet. But maybe the 25th time you're going to get hit by a car, it's not worth the chance. Go to the corner if you have to cross over or if you have to get in the street. Look around from both sides. That's the wise thing to do. To cross in between is foolish. You can get hurt. And so we believe that, not from our experience, because experience was telling us different. Experience was saying you can get away with it. But we listened to our mom because we trusted her. That's preconventional ethics. This is right thing to do because mom says it is and she must be wise. So that's, Kohlberg says, is preconventional. Conventional, which is the next developmental level, is what we'd call the ethics of teenagers. And this is the dangerous land. And part of my problem is that I haven't left my adolescence too much. When I make mistakes, it's almost like being still a teenager. Teenage morality or teenage ethics is called conventional, where I see something as right or wrong, not because of my parents' authority, but because of my peer group tells me it's so. A group tells me it's so. It could be the group of my church. It could be that my government tells me it's good to go to war. You know, my government says it's all right to murder people if you're doing it for your country. Or my peer group says it's all right to do this. Don't listen to the old people. Those are old foggies. That's the old way. We're the new way. So that's conventional morality is based on the group. My understanding of what the group says is right. If the group says it's right, I'm going to go with it. Because the group says it's right. And that group can be my peer group. It can be a church group. It could be a political group, and I follow that because I trust in the group the way I did trust in my mother. I no longer trust in my mother and my father. Now I trust in the group because I'm one of the group. So Kohlberg says when a person, a teenager, or a person feels one of a group, then he has identity with that group, and he goes with that group. That's what the group decides what's right and what's wrong. Then Kohlberg says, if we succeed and live long enough to get into the next level, which is post-conventional, we suddenly begin to realize that something is right because it's universally right. It's right for every person who lives, past, present, and future. It has nothing to do with this group at my present time. It's not situational. It's not related to my time or my group. It's universally good. And that requires some type of educational process to get to that. And so the phrase for post-conventional ethics, or the ethics that is universally right, is do what's right because it is right. Do what's right because it is right. Not because I tell you it's right, not because, you know, the government tells you it's right or your group tells you it's right. Do what is right because you can see it is right. That's the beginning of true ethics and true virtue, is to have that kind of discernment again, which goes back to what Socrates was showing us with that slave boy, is that he sees that this is the rightness of this formula. And it's right for everybody at all times, not just right for him, or not just right for now, or not just right for Socrates. It's right because it's right, and it's right there forever. So the true morality comes from seeing the rightness of something because it is right. And when I make a moral decision, an ethical decision, I'm not making it just for me, I'm making it for everybody. If this is right for me, it is right because it's right universally for everybody. And that's the highest form of virtue, the highest form of morality or of ethics it can be. One of the reasons why I'm sharing this with you might be wondering, that, and I don't know if you're aware of this, but one of my responsibilities that I've hinted at a few times is to introduce our adolescent group, our middle school students, to philosophy, to wisdom, to ethics. That here at our school, they've been learning all kinds of things, and now when they get into the adolescent moment, it's timely for them to get into that realm of human experience, which is philosophy. And primarily because of the importance they need to have in philosophy of having a moral life, an ethical life, at this age of young adulthood, becoming young men and becoming young women, they need that. So I want you to know as parents that our school, in embracing the development of your children, is interested as well in developing their morality and their philosophical experiences and minds as they get older into our middle school. So 4 days a week here at our school, I've got a group of adolescents that I'm dealing in philosophy with. And we get into this whole issue of what is right and what is wrong and why is it. It's interesting to know that you have this development as, you know, as children go up, where they are being nurtured by their parents in every way, not just with food, then being nurtured in everything. That's that pre-conventional. And then the young child in Montessori from the age of 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 is focused on experience and developing strong attentiveness, intentionality and intensive to their personal experience and seeing what is there and learning mathematics that way and learning language that way by attending to the concrete experiences. And then when they get into the adolescent period of time, which is the middle school, we then want them to look up, so to speak, and look at the universal truths that exist, not just in the concrete, but universally, which has to do with man as man, what has virtues as virtue.